All right, gentlemen, congratulations on a guilty verdict and a job well done on the Chauvin trial. I don't know if anybody's pointed this out yet, but the jury deliberated for just over 9 hours and 29 minutes. When you heard they came to a verdict in that amount of time in such a big case, did you feel pretty good going into to the reading of the verdict?
Yeah, I think we did. They hadn't asked any questions. Mm-hmm. There were no requests for information. And, they received the case fairly late in the day, on the first day, and then hadn't been deliberating really that long. And so I think both of us felt pretty good going in.
Cautiously optimistic.
Exactly.
That it looked pretty good. In that amount of time, they really had not had much time to have robust arguments about a great deal. So we figured they must have been pretty much on the same page. And I didn't see it likely that they would have come out with just a blanket acquittal in that amount of time.
Mm-hmm. Have you heard any feedback from any of the jurors who served in this?
No, well, other than what anybody else would have seen just on television from an alternate who has made some comments.
Right. So backing up then, can you both share, Attorney General Keith Ellison called you, asked you to be on this case. What goes through your head? Does it matter who else is on it? What are the kind of considerations you put into it when deciding to do this?
Well, that's a good question. Who else is on it? Did you know who else was going to be on it?
I had no idea who else was on it.
I had no idea either. I'd never met Jerry before.
Right.
Really?
No. I'd never met Mr. Ellison. I'd never met the Attorney General before he called me. He called and asked if I would provide assistance with the case, and my first thought was yes. You know, the Attorney General of the state called and asked for help, and you should do that. Mm-hmm. If the Attorney General calls you, certainly have been privileged to serve the state in different capacities as a prosecutor before, justice is important, policing is important to me, and so that was what went through my mind, and asked who else was on the team. Very pleasant to be able to then come away from this meeting somebody who I have great respect and admiration for his work and consider a friend that I gained from this.
Mm-hmm.
No, likewise, and in fact, I have described myself in this case as an alligator in a saltwater crocodile pond. Because I've come from a different environment altogether, so I had...
Meaning mostly civil and so forth?
Yeah, okay. Exclusively civil.
Yeah.
And so I've never been involved in a criminal case. So when I got the phone call, I'd already seen the video and had a reaction to the video that this is one of these moments kind of in history. There's a time for every person. When you see something that so shocks your conscience, you feel this is the time to stand up and be counted. And that video was my moment.
Mm-hmm.
And I had thought I want to do whatever I can in support of justice with respect to this. And out of the blue, the phone call comes from the Attorney General. And the only two lawyers I knew were the Attorney General, but known for some years, and Lola Velasquez Aguilu, and the rest of the team. I had no idea who they were, how many they were, where they'd be coming from. Had never heard of a Steve Slisher, let alone been able to spell his name. simply just agreed to serve this way. I try cases on the civil side, and I was asked to be involved because I try cases in different parts of the country, and the Attorney General thought the skill set might be useful.
You know, one aspect of that our viewers latched on to is the pro bono aspect. Why do it pro bono?
Well, again, it harkens back to my other answer to do it pro bono, because this was purely a service, in my view. It wasn't about any degree of enrichment for myself or the law firm. It was a service to the people, a service to equal justice, a service to the meaning of the rule of law in the state.
Mm-hmm.
And I knew it would be helpful to the state if they had to pay fewer individuals.
Yeah.
It makes it possible to offer a more robust form of justice.
Yeah.
So I agreed then I would do it pro bono, as did Mr. Slisher. You know?
And this is what we're supposed to do as attorneys. Attorneys in Minnesota, we have a fantastic tradition of attorneys in Minnesota stepping up and doing pro bono work. It's what we're supposed to do. And you know, my firm has been involved in a lot of pro bono work over the years, and they were completely supportive. It's a responsibility that we have because we're in a profession. It's a privilege to be in this profession. It's a wonderful profession, the practice of law. To be able to make a living serving others in the practice of law is a blessing. And so this is what we're supposed to do.
This was a learning experience for a lot of our viewers. We aired every single day of the trial on TV live on Channel 11. So, sometimes I would get too complicated and have to take a step back. And people are like, well, how much time does it take to put together a case like this?
Oh, my. Yeah. Tremendous amounts of time and sweat and muscle. I think we started our regular meetings in June.
Yeah.
Of last year, and we were then having multiple planning preparation meetings a week since last June, right up and through the time of trial.
Mm-hmm.
So if you can imagine having a weekly all-hands meeting, plus we had then individual projects we're working on in prosecution of the matter, which was additional kind of hours every week in the planning for the prosecution of this. So if you add that up, that was generally how much time, with the idea that the month or two before trial, it's what you did for life.
Right.
You know, eat, breathe, sleep.
You dream about the case.
Correct. Dream about the case.
And I mean, you wake up in the middle of a conversation with a witness, but but it was a dream.
Right.
No, you're working all of the time because that's what it takes to put a case together. We have the sole burden of proof, right?
Yep.
You know, we have the burden of proof, and they're a lot of witnesses and a lot of things to cover. And so it took a lot, mm-hmm. a lot of work, took all of us.
So one more question on the setup of stuff. How do you prevent it from becoming a too many cooks in the kitchen situation where you're all talented, you all have different legal backgrounds, and I would assume you're all proud people, and how do you stop the headbutting from inevitably occurring?
The Attorney General. I mean, he is, you know, there's two parts to that title, the attorney and the general, right? And he is tactically a very good attorney and really was the person who constructed the order of witnesses and our strategy, both legally and presentation-wise. But very much a general. We had a division of labor. We had accountability. We had redundancy. We put together a plan and we executed the plan. That's how we did it. And also, just in terms of working together within that structure, we began to see each other and understand. Jerry's very talented at what he does. I enjoy practicing law. I love being in trial. This is what I do. And to see someone else at the top of their craft like that, how am I going to fight with that, right? It's an opportunity of a lifetime to work with some very talented people. So we didn't have a lot of that headbutting because there was a respect that developed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, robust debate, robust discussion on any number of issues, and that was just a constant. But if a call had to be made, then you knew who made the call.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And once it was made, you aligned and you march on.
Could each of you share which witness in this trial stuck with you the most, as well as which witness, it might be a different one, was the most important to earning the conviction?
Well, I'll let you start with that.
Sure. I've been asked that question before, and for me, it wasn't a single witness. Right? It was the whole piece. You know, I talk about us having a plan. We had a plan, right? We had a plan. We developed the plan. We executed the plan. It was important that all of the components come together, the bystanders, right, the law enforcement piece, the medical piece, and just watching all of that work together, every single part of it. For me, that's what I was enjoying the most, I guess, to the extent you can enjoy something like this, just to see it all kind of come together. Mm-hmm. But not a particular, not a one witness for me. It was really just watching the whole thing unfold.
Mm-hmm. And for me, I thought they were all important. So I agree with what Steve has said, and I would not point to any of them as a witness that we could have done without, and certainly amongst the expert ranks. But when I think about winning what I call the hearts and the minds both of jurors, heart-wise, I mean, you couldn't listen to Charles McMillan and I think have any element of humanness in you and not resonate to the genuine pain, the expressions of caring and anguish that he expressed from the stand, from Mr. McMillan. I think just won the hearts at any notion that these bystanders were an unruly mob, an uncaring group of a violent of humanity. They weren't that. You can see this is a caring individual that even a year after the fact is still racked with remorse, in tears over a person he didn't even know. So I think he overall won hearts. And then for the minds of the jurors, it's a trial where our theory of how this occurred is that Mr. Floyd died of low oxygen. Dr. Tobin, I think, was the witness who could actually talk with the jurors about what was the quantity of oxygen in his lungs, what were his reserves, and was it enough to sustain life for anyone? So to that extent, I thought Dr. Tobin won the minds.
Absolutely. This all played out. I mean, everybody knows Charles McMillan now because this was on TV. It was televised and streamed around the world. How did that change the way you guys did your jobs? And do you have a different appreciation for cameras in the courts than you did before? Or what's your take on that? I know, I mean, I asked the Attorney General about it. The state fought the cameras.
Mm-hmm. It didn't affect the way we did our job any more than it would affect the way you go shopping at Target, right? There's cameras all over the place. And the cameras were unobtrusive. I get very focused when I'm in trial. I don't think about other things at all. And so for me personally, it wasn't something that was on my mind. I was doing a job, and that presentation was not for the broader TV viewing audience. That was for the jurors. Those were that was our audience. You know, as far as cameras in the courtroom, I think that there are certainly pros and cons. On the pro side, a lot of people learned a lot, right? And there's transparency, and I think that that's important. There's certainly an educational component. For the cons, I think that it can be very difficult. You think about witnesses who, by no choice of their own, became witnesses to something that was shocking and horrific, and then they're subpoenaed to testify, and then as a part of that, they're going to be broadcast all over. And I think that can be really tough. I also think it can be difficult in a world where we have this sort of anonymous ability to say really terrible things about each other mm-hmm. online without consequence, right? And seeing some comments directed at witnesses that I thought were unfair mm-hmm. And just mean was disappointing.
Sure.
I agree with everything Steve said in that regard. There wasn't, for me, much of a consciousness of the cameras in the courtroom. Mm-hmm. The courtroom itself was such a different environment than what we're used to seeing, with the plexiglass everywhere, the mm-hmm. not being the typical jury box. The cameras were themselves tucked away. They weren't in your face. They weren't on the floor. So there wasn't much of an awareness of it. Otherwise, I was self-conscious in the way anybody might be. I mean, if you thought for a second that when you sit down at home for dinner, the whole world is going to watch you, you might pass on dinner as opposed to having those mashed potatoes. And so we had sort of that degree of awareness that anything you do, somebody from Poland is writing to you about it. Mm-hmm. But after you kind of get into what you're doing in the courtroom, you didn't really pay any attention.
Derek Chauvin chose not to testify. Who was ready to cross-examine him, and how would that have gone if he chose to testify?
We were, but especially Mr. Slisher.
And of course, I mean, it's his constitutional right to not testify. We bear the sole burden of proof. But we were prepared for every aspect of this case, that being one of them. I was prepared to cross-examine him. And, I guess we just leave it at that.
You had permission from the judge to go into two prior incidents that involved Derek Chauvin, and you chose not to go into them during this trial. Why was that?
Because what this case was about 9 minutes and 29 seconds. Just like Jerry said in the opening and just like we said in the closing. Mm-hmm. Other prior instances of misconduct or even just showing knowledge of the right way to do the job, those are good. But, you know, really what this case was about what happened on the ground, that restraint on the ground, that unauthorized and excessive use of force. Mm-hmm. And so we decided to keep the main thing the main thing.
Mm-hmm. How do you find out about all that stuff about him? I mean, you know, I read all the motions before the trial started, and I think there were 17 total that you had identified, or even more.
We just review records. You know, during the course of an investigation, you get search warrants, you obtain records of agencies and whatnot, you know, comb through the files. But I have no comment on any of those past instances. Okay.
From a, you know, talk a little bit about the strategy here. Are there different ways that this case could have been tried in general? Could you explain maybe an example and explain why you tried it the way that you did?
Always. Different ways you can try a case, and there are different ways it can be tried, and they will all be effective, too. But the strategy here was primarily crafted, driven by the Attorney General. I mean, it was a huge strategic decision, for example, as to where and when do we start to tell the story. Do you tell it chronologically? On May 25th, he went to Cup Foods at 7 o'clock p.m. and so on, and bring it forward. Or do you start it in the middle of the action, you know, the 929? Mm-hmm. And we figured, let us first define the main thing, which was the 929, and then focus on keeping the main thing the main thing. And that was a strategic decision early on, and that we started there in the subdual and restraint on the ground, and we essentially panned the camera back from there temporarily to mm-hmm. see what happened earlier in the day, and then to bring the jurors and the audience forward from there. But that was a strategic call in how to tell our story. What's the narrative?
Anything to add to that?
No, I agree with what Jerry said. And we felt it effective. And again, part of that whole overall strategy, what was the crime here, right? What was the crime? The crime was the restraint on the ground. That was the crime.
Mm-hmm. We weren't able to see the jurors except for, you know, the pool reporters that were in the courtroom each day, which is a unique way to cover a trial. You guys looked at the jurors every single day. Mm-hmm. Was this jury afraid to acquit Derek Chauvin because of the possibility of protesters coming to their house if it was the verdict that the protesters didn't want?
I think the answer to that's no. But even in the jury selection, I mean, if some juror felt that way and didn't feel that they could render a fair and impartial judgment, they could have held up a hand, and very few had any difficulties getting off the jury if they didn't want to serve in this trial, as you may have noticed from the jury selection. So they took an oath and committed to decide the case on evidence and not be swayed by any of those kinds of considerations, and I believe they did it.
Mm-hmm. I agree, and particularly because we presented overwhelming evidence of guilt and no reasonable person could see it any other way. And so I don't think that they decided this case based on any sort of external factors. There's a presumption in the law that the jurors follow the judge's instructions, and I don't think that there's any evidence that they were influenced by anything on the outside.
Mm-hmm. What did you see on the jurors' faces every day?
Attentiveness.
They took copious notes. They were very much tuned into the testimony. They didn't emote, as in you didn't hear exclamations or mm-hmm. guffaws or any of that. But you could see that they were all kind of very tuned in. It wasn't like some trials I've been in where there are certain jurors who are sleeping a good part of it, or they take turns sleeping for parts of it. Really, none of that to speak of in any significant way from this jury. So I thought it was an attentive jury, a smart jury, and I saw them taking lots of notes.
It was somber. I mean, during COVID, we get used to just seeing each other's eyes because everybody's masked, and it did. They were leaned forward, they were locked in, taking notes, but it was a very somber, I think everybody was taking this very seriously. As juries tend to do, I mean, I practiced as a prosecutor for over 2 decades, done a lot of jury trials, and I think that the juries, everybody says they don't want to be on jury service, and they're always so proud that they did it, and so glad that they did it after. And I think they take their job very seriously.
Yeah, just as a brief aside, during the breaks when we would have to do the commentary and stuff on TV, I would wait for that pool note to come from the pool reporter and be like, okay, I got the pool note. Juror number 14 is taking notes. Juror number 3 is taking notes. And so yeah. It never was as dramatic like what you would expect. Like
right.
Juror 3 cried out or it was not.
Right.
Taking notes just about sums up what I heard.
That was about it.
Yeah.
So, technical question. You know, we did a lot of talking about the charges, and the second degree murder charge was added on just a little bit after the initial charges that Derek Chauvin faced. And a lot of people were wondering whether that assault portion could be proved in this case, which it was. Could you give me any insight into, you know, how this second degree murder charge was brought into the mix, you know, and how it was thought, you know, we can prove this?
Now, actually, that decision was made by the Attorney General before either of us were brought in to the charging decision. In our own discussions of the law and the legal theories going forward, and the Attorney General told me on the phone that that was what the charge was going to be. And in my experience, I considered it for a moment and thought to myself, well, that's exactly the right charge. I mean, an unauthorized use of force is in fact an assault, causing loss of consciousness, is substantial bodily harm. That's assault three. And it just made a lot of sense. Then communicating that, like being able to teach the jury what the law requires and show how the facts fit into those elements, you know, that can be challenging because it's just different. You know, it's not a complicated concept, but it's just different from how you typically think of murder. But I thought the charge fit very well. And we also thought it was important that the jury have different options to choose from, to be able to consider the same conduct in different legal frameworks.
I think this is probably the last question. Well, first, let me do two more. The video, particularly Darnella's video, was the video that millions and millions and millions of people have seen. And obviously there was a lot of decisions to be made about how you presented it. And you know, don't play it too much that the jury gets desensitized to it. Can you talk a little bit about what you felt was appropriate as far as this video and how important of a piece of evidence it was?
It was a centrally, critically important piece of evidence. As you remember, I played it in an opening statement and simply played it. It was best, in my view, to, and the team's as well, to simply play it in its natural native state, just as is, with very little lawyer commentary, interpretation, spin, or speak. And that it pretty much spoke for itself, that persons of ordinary sensibilities would see that video and have the reaction that there was something gravely wrong that happened there. And that's the central focus and point of our case. We did have the concern that jurors might get desensitized to it, seeing it too much. But on the other hand, given all the times we had seen it, every time we would see it, it would do something to you every single time. It's just that stark. And so we didn't want to overplay it. But what we found was interesting is that when you bring experts in to then focus on specific aspects of it, there are things that you didn't notice. When you're watching the video, you didn't notice the foot is completely off the ground. You didn't notice the shimmying that takes place until it slowed down and you really focus. And we felt that was going to be okay to draw the jurors' attention to specific things in the video, but to play it in toto, you know, not that often that they will see snippets of it throughout the whole trial.
One day that was particularly tough, I think, was when we had our witness up, our foundational witness, and we played all the body camera videos kind of back to back. You know, that was a difficult day, I think, for everyone. Difficult day for the jurors as well, it must have been. But we had to do that to show all of the different perspectives and angles of this incident. From the perspective of the officers wearing the cameras, from the perspective of the street far back and how they all related to each other. After that day, when we got through that day, we really didn't play the whole thing again. It was just certain segments because you know we believed that they had enough. I mean, they've seen it, and now we can just focus in on particular parts. But desensitized, you know, no. Every time we watched it,
And so, just to get on the record, Jerry thought of the "You Can Believe Your Eyes" theme. For the prosecution?
Yeah, you know, I wouldn't own that as simply a Jerry creation because the themes were really sort of collectively come about with our discussions in the team. The role that I had with the team initially was to work on the narrative and the themes. But we vetted them, we kicked them around, and we saw which ones really resonate with the facts we have. So I couldn't own that as much as I'd like to.
Jerry was the first one to say that, okay. Right? In our meetings, that came out of his mouth first, and it did resonate with the team because, you know, that really was what the case was about, was just providing the jury the assurance that they could believe their eyes, that what they saw was wrong, and the wrongfulness is what killed George Floyd. And that's why we called the police officers and the experts in law enforcement to assure them that, yes, you're seeing what you're seeing, that's wrong. Mm-hmm. And to call the medical experts to give them the assurance that, you know, of course, you know, you see this and think to yourself, that must have killed him. And that's exactly what they told the jury, that they could do that. And it was really just sort of an assurance of that first video that we played.
So last question, you've both had accomplished careers before taking this call, but where does this case now stand for each of you?
It's not over.
Right.
Yeah. You know, I'd say first, it's not over. It has been to me a wonderful service. We didn't go out to engage in celebrations and that sort of thing afterward, because what happened here really was and is a tragedy in the true sense of the word, and there are no winners in a tragedy. So you don't, to me, go out for those kinds of celebrations, even if as a society we positively benefit from lessons learned, or if it propels us forward in a positive direction. So I think where it takes us in the near term is looking toward the next set of trials in August and wanting to complete the job. So that's where my focus is now, is in trying to complete this process of justice, and it won't be completed until we've addressed the other officers who were involved on that day on May 25th.
Well, I agree with Jerry. I mean, we just need to focus on the task ahead, and then just as far as when all of it's over, I mean, you know, the practice of law is a privilege, and it's taken me in places that I never thought I would be. We'll just wait for the next thing to happen.
Mm-hmm. Have you folks decided specifically what sentence to ask Judge Cahill for when Derek Chauvin is sentenced in June?
No, we haven't. We, you know, the Attorney General has been clear that the state is not seeking revenge.
Correct.
Right? They're seeking a reasonable sentence. And, you know, sentencing a person is probably the most difficult thing, the most difficult decision a judge has to make. And so Judge Cahill, you know, has a tough job ahead of him.